Let us revise a few important recommendations given by the American Society of Anaesthesiologists regarding putting or securing a central venous access in children. And with the increasing use of central line, all residents must know this. So, we know that for preparation, we need an aseptic environment, a standardized equipment set, a checklist, and an assistant. Now, for prevention of infectious complications, an IV antibiotic prophylaxis is required for immunocompromised patients and high-risk neonates, the decision to be taken on a case-to-case basis, and no routine antibiotic prophylaxis is required if you are putting a central line. Then aseptic techniques like hand washing and maximum barrier precautions like gowns, gloves, caps, masks, and full body patient drapes need to be used. And especially with the COVID times, we all have become adjusted and accustomed to all this. And a chlorhexidine containing solution should be used for skin preparation in adults, infants, and children. But such a solution to be used in neonates should be based on your clinical judgment and institutional protocol, because it might not be very safe. And if ever there is a contraindication to the use of chlorhexidine containing solution, povidone iodine or alcohol based solution can be used. So catheters coated with antibiotics or a combination of chlorhexidine and silver sulfadiazine should be used for selected patients. And catheter insertion site should not be contaminated or potentially contaminated. It should not even be potentially contaminated. For example, burned or infected skin, inguinal area should preferably be avoided, especially in adults, because of the risk of transmission of genitourinary infections, and adjacent to tracheostomy and open surgical wound, especially in children. Upper body insertion site is used in adults, as already discussed in the previous line. And whether or not you will use sutures or staples or tape for fixation of the catheter is to be determined on a local or institutional basis. Transparent bio-occlusive dressings should be used, and these should preferably contain chlorhexidine in adults, infants, and children. And the use of same in neonates should again be based on clinical judgment and institutional protocol. And the duration of catheterization should be assessed daily. Daily, the need of the persistence of central venous catheter should be assessed, and it should be removed as early as possible. The site should be inspected daily for infections, and it should be replaced if the central venous access needs to be continued. Then the second catheter should be secured at a new insertion site and not at the same site. And catheter access ports should be wiped off with appropriate antiseptic before every access. This the nurses should be instructed very properly. Every time they are putting injection or drawing blood, the ports should be cleaned. And central venous catheter stopcocks or access ports should be capped. And needleless catheter access ports may also be used on a case-to-case basis. The catheter size should be preferably the smallest catheter size which is appropriate. And the decision to place two catheters in a single vein should also be made on a case-to-case basis. Static ultrasound imaging should be used in elective situations before preparing and draping for identification of anatomy to determine the vessel localization and patency, especially in cases of internal jugular vein, even though it can be used for femoral and subclavian veins as well. And real-time ultrasound guidance should be used if IJV is being selected for cannulation, even though you can use for subclavian and femoral as well, but it might not be feasible in emergency circumstances because of the presence of other clinical constraints. Venous access, the fact that you have gained venous access can be determined, should be confirmed by methods like ultrasound, manometry, pressure waveform analysis, or venous blood gas measurement. Blood color and absence of pulsatile flow should not always be relied upon for confirming that you have secured a venous access, which residents most of the time do at bedside. And they say that if it is a cherry red color, then it is arterial blood, and if pulsatile flow is present, then it is an arterial blood. But I must tell you that even arterial blood can look dark tinged like venous blood. and the pulsatile flow can be absent even in arterial blood, especially in hypoxemic conditions and conditions of shock. So these clinical markers should not always be relied upon for confirming that you have secured venous access. So for confirming whether the wire is in the vein or not, you can go for surface ultrasound, transesophageal echocardiography to identify the wire in SVC or right atrium, and a continuous electrocardiography can be done or fluoroscopy can also be done. After final catheterization and before use, you should confirm the placement of catheter in the venous system by waveform manometry or by pressure measurement. The final position of the catheter tip should also be confirmed by chest radiography, fluoroscopy or continuous electrocardiography. So at every step it might not be possible to confirm, but you must make an effort definitely to confirm all these things. Now if you have placed the central venous catheter in the operating room, a chest X-ray should be obtained as early as possible because you can make the necessary rectifications there and then itself. In case of inadvertent arterial puncture in neonates, infants or children, the decision to obtain consultation from a general or a vascular surgeon or to remove the catheter non-surgically by your own self should be based on your judgment, skill and an experience. So this is a checklist I found in the guidelines and I find it very useful, which all of us must use for insertion of the central line. Thank you so much for a patient watching, and please do share the knowledge. Thanks a lot.